P.T. Barnum, the Senator of Connecticut in 1879 and the root of women's strides for healthcare rising in the 20th century. Barnum passed a law that prohibited the use of any drug, medicinal article, or instrument for the purpose of preventing contraception. Though followed and preceded by similar laws in other states, the Barnum Act, as it was known, easily became one of the most restrictive laws on birth control in America. For years, married couples would face arrest, prosecution, and imprisonment for known family planning in the U.S. Over time, the control of the Barnum Act appeared to fade as more and more doctors began to prescribe contraception under the table, finally coming to its real peak in the 1920s as the Connecticut Birth Control League, a group started by Margaret Sanger in 1914, began opening up offices throughout Connecticut in an attempt to repeal state legislation. This was the beginning of Planned Parenthood. This struggle continued for decades. Consistently throughout history and still today, large decisions on women's rights are made by men in power, often without the presence of a female. However, the men of Connecticut had never met Estelle Griswold or Dr. C. Lee Buxton. In 1960, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration had approved a form of oral contraceptive, still not legal in the state of Connecticut, that had the potential to provide hundreds of women with the ability to control their own bodies and futures. The pair opened a clinic in Waterbury as an act of political protest against the Barnum Act, and immediately they received numerous requests from women, particularly married women, for information about birth control. But just a few days after the opening of the clinic on November 9, 1961, Griswold and Lee were arrested. The clinic was shut down, and they were each fined $100, equal to approximately $846 in 2018. Before this, the rise of Planned Parenthood had been the subject of many past legal disputes, including another case brought to the court, Tilston v. Ullman, which argued that the lack of contraception rights in some cases greatly endangered women, yet was dismissed from the Supreme Court due to the lack of standing to sue on behalf of the patients. Similarly, Lee brought the case Poe v. Ullman, which argued the Barnum Law violated the 14th Amendment of the Constitution, to court. Once again, dismissed, but this time on the grounds of lack of conflict to resolve. However, this time Griswold and Dr. Buxton were determined to be heard and represented in the federal court, and so became the case of Griswold v. Connecticut, which states that the Connecticut law that banned contraception violated a right to marital privacy, citing the Fourth Amendment. The 1960s represented a changing time for women from the release of Betty Friedan's book in 1963, The Feminine Mystique, in which she urged women to, quote, break out of the household trap and truly find fulfillment as wives and mothers by fulfilling their own unique possibilities as separate human beings, end quote. As well as the rise in more organizations for women's rights, such as the National Organization for Women. More and more women were stepping away from the dedicated housewife stereotype and instead stepping towards politics, education, and the workforce. In the 60s, 1 in 5 women with children under 6 and 1/4 of women with children over 16 held a job. More women than ever were entering the workforce, but more importantly, more women than ever were able to. By the end of the 60s, over 80% of women able to have kids were using the oral pill released just a decade prior. While now we have even more forms available to us, like IUDs, injections, and implants, the pill still remains the most used female contraceptive method on the market across every religion, race, and cultural identity in the United States. According to the Guttmacher Institute, women's ability to obtain and effectively use contraceptives has a positive impact on their education and workforce participation, as well as on subsequent outcomes related to family, income, stability, mental health, happiness, and children's well-being. Overall, women use contraception for any number of reasons, including to have healthier pregnancies, to help timing, various illnesses outside the realm of sexual activity, and to space births. Planning a pregnancy can prevent many complications that could endanger a woman's health, including gestational diabetes and high blood pressure. And women who wait for some time after delivery before becoming pregnant again lower their risk of adverse birth outcomes, such as low birth weight and preterm birth. Without this access, women's health care could greatly decrease. In fact, in the 2000s, 58% of women who used the pill used it for non-sexual related reasons, such as menstrual pain, regulation, and a disorder called endometriosis. What this shows is that whether or not you are sexually active, contraception, particularly the oral pill, is a staple in women's healthcare. The reason why we have these options is because of the Griswold v. Connecticut case. Birth control not only leads to happier, healthier lives, but also improves the economy. Not only do women who have access to family planning make 40% higher earnings than those who don't, but for every $1 we invest in family planning, we save $4 elsewhere, in resources like water, public health, even sanitation. This is economically beneficial to the entire country. While women still have to pay around $50 a month in the US, around $600 a year, it's clear that not only is contraception a lucrative market, but within the 60s alone, young female participation in the workforce increased by over 7%. And by the 1990s, the wage gap was over a third of the way closed. The main reason why this case is a massive turning point for women's rights is not just the economic or health benefits. While the CDC did name family planning one of the 10 great public health achievements of the 20th century, alongside vaccinations and control of infectious diseases, the case itself, focusing only on marital privacy, was not nearly as influential as what came after. In this case, the court recognized a, quote, zone of privacy created by several fundamental constitutional guarantees. This zone was cited in many other court cases to come, including Einstadt v. Bayard, which extended to unmarried couples, the infamous Roe v. Wade, Carey v. Population Services, and even Lawrence v. Texas, which allowed same-sex relationships. Overall, the Griswold v. Connecticut court case had a massive impact on the basic rights of women, and without Griswold and Buxton, we would not be where we are today.